Good morning.
Morning.
Welcome to worship this morning. I'm happy to see you. I have had several of our members over the past week say they were going to be out of town this week, and I was getting concerned it might only be me here. So I'm extraordinarily pleased to see all of you here this morning, and I welcome you to worship. Announcements this morning. I'll direct your attention to the back of the bulletin where we list those calendar items for you. Of course, tomorrow being the 4th of July, the office will be closed here at the church. Also wanted to make sure that you are aware, in preparation for the annual meeting, a copy of the proposed budget is available for you at the Welcome Center to look at prior to the meeting. So if you have any questions or any thoughts, you can have those ready for the meeting. Also, on Wednesday evening, July 6th, the nominating team will be meeting. So, again, I'll remind you, out at the Welcome Center, we have that beautiful picture chart of our council members and team leaders. If you're wondering if your name is on it, we have a problem. You should know if your name is on it. But if you're telling me your name is on it and you don't want it to be, or you're telling me your name is not on it and you want it to be, either of those things would be a worthy discussion I would be willing to have with you. And be praying for us as a nominating team also as we start approaching those who might be considering church leadership here. That annual meeting is July 17th, following the worship service, so please put that on your calendar. Also, the Women of Faith, that information there regarding the rummage sale and produce sale. We've been running that announcement for a while, but please pay attention to that. And if you have items that you would like to bring for the sale, those instructions are there for you also. On August 4th, we'll be helping serve pie at the Okoboji Bible Conference. So if you are interested in that, the sign-up sheet is to come, I understand. This is the time when I say any other announcements for the good of the people. Rod's got a mic in the back. He's happy to come to you if you have anything that you would like to share. And there's a hand in the air. We have a taker.
Just a couple things. The property team's been very busy on the outside of the building. Rhonda and Kathy are working on new plants, replace the ones that have died. And Daryl and Mick have power washed pretty much the outside of the building. And it really looks different, and you had to be there to see the difference. So Mick was in high places. Good job, Mick.
Any other announcements this morning? I do know there are some upcoming mission events. The Cherish House is going to be having one of their baby bottle fundraisers here at Faith. We've got Meals on Wheels coming up again. Maribeth is nodding. Those announcements will be to come, correct? So keep an eye out for those as well. No other announcements? Let's start with some praise this morning. If you would stand, we will sing together, starting with number 384 in your hymnal, Spirit Song, and then the very next one, Where the Spirit of the Lord Is. Let's stand and praise together.
Spirit, direct this love.
Scripture tells us on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, knowing that he was about to be arrested and beaten and crucified, he gathered together at the table with his disciples, and he gave them some great symbols in their meal. He took bread, and he broke that bread after giving thanks, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Every time you do this, every time you take this bread, do it in remembrance of me." And in the same way, when the supper was over, he took the cup and he gave thanks. And he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." And he said, "Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So, brothers and sisters, we set the table today in remembrance of Jesus and what he has done for us. And as we prepare to partake in the holy sacrament of communion, won't you take a moment for silent prayer, a prayer of confession or a petition for grace, a conversation with your Lord and Savior. Please be in prayer. Lord, pour out your Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Let them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by his blood. It's in your name. Amen. Today we take from the same loaf, the same cup, and in all our differences, at the communion table, we are the same, broken, but made whole, sinners, but made clean. The table is often where Jesus kind of intersected with the best and the worst of humanity. Jesus dined with people who sat on the fringe of society. He reclined at tables and shared food with people who were ignored by religion and government. And when the temple was defiled by money changers, Jesus flipped those tables. Now we find ourselves at the table. Who will join us? Social and religious boundaries are no match for grace. The table is prepared and the table is endless. We are all welcome to the table. So if you're poor, we can't promise that you will be rich, but we will show you the richness of God's love. If you are broken, we wrap our arms around you and help hold you together with the redemption found in Christ. If you're a person who feels lost, you are loved, and we sit beside you at the table. If you've left religion, but you still feel a longing for God, you are loved, and we sit at the table beside you. If you are young or old or middle-aged, you are loved. We sit beside you at the table. If you are unsure about your next paycheck, your next job, or your next meal, you are loved, and we sit beside you at the table. God loves you. And you are welcome to the table. Here at Faith Community Church, we do serve by open table, meaning anyone who loves Jesus and earnestly repents of their sin is welcome to partake. You need not be a member of this church or any church. We are serving by intinction this morning. I will place a piece of the bread in your hands, and you may dip in the chalice. If you are uncomfortable with that method for any means, please partake at your level of comfort or be in your pew in communion with us in spirit. I'll ask you to come forward through the center aisle and return to your seats by the outside aisle. And I invite our communion stewards to come forward. And I invite all of you to be served.
Thank you.
My brothers and sisters, would you look at the person to your left, if there's someone to your left? Look at the person to your right, if there's someone to your right. Look at the person behind you. Look at the person in front of you, not me, the person sitting in front of you. These are the people sitting beside you at the table. They're your church family. They're your brothers and sisters. They are your neighbors. And they are the people you'll be working with on the mission field. Won't you take a moment to stand and greet one another this morning? If you've been here or been watching over the last few weeks, we have covered some really heavy topics with our sermon series, Four Letter Words. Today we're going to wrap that series up, and it is my prayer that you have been challenged, that you have come face to face with some of these words that we've been talking about, fear and hell and holy and obey, words that sometimes churches don't talk about and Christians don't talk about, because these words can have such a huge impact on how you live this life and also how you spend eternity. So I hope you have felt convicted in some way. Like the other words that we've discussed, today our word is lost, and that word can be offensive to some people. Some ways it might seem easier to avoid talking about the lost rather than to discuss it. After all, we don't want people to feel alienated in some way. We don't want to offend anyone. We don't want to be politically incorrect. And we think that if we talk about the lost, somehow we're labeling people. We don't want to do that. We don't want to come across either like we're somehow special because we're found. We don't want to be holier than thou, right, in our approach. But the Bible teaches that some people are lost and some people are found. It's one of the most basic principles that's found in Scripture. And being lost could be devastating. And you know, when we think about being lost, we really don't give it a whole lot of serious consideration. We think of it as being confused or maybe a little bit uninformed. Maybe we think of lost as being relatively harmless. How many of you were here for this service when everybody's bulletin had a different hymn number on it and we were playing different songs? I said I wanted you to know what it felt like to be lost, right? Were you scared? Were you harmed in some way by that practice? No, you kind of laughed it off and said, that pastor is nuts, right? So Oftentimes, we joke a little bit about being lost. It's harmless. But there again, in the Bible, what it means to be lost, that means headed toward destruction, to be perishing. In Romans chapter 6, the Apostle Paul says, "For the wages of sin is death." Does that sound harmless to you? Now, some people are going to take offense at being called lost because they think it sounds rude or insensitive. How many of you would say, "Yeah, I really like it if somebody says, 'Boy, you are lost'"? Doesn't feel very good, does it? Doesn't feel affirming. I get it. But please, I want you to understand the word lost has to be in our vocabulary in the church. Because we believe that the Bible teaches that being lost is absolutely devastating. And if you die in that state, or if Christ returns before your spiritual status changes, then you are lost forever. All of eternity. And I am sorry if you think that's being insensitive or if that's offensive to you. But I'm saying it for exactly the opposite reason. I'm saying it because I love you, because I'm concerned for you. I don't want anyone to be lost. I don't know how many of you are familiar with a duo of magicians called Penn and Teller. They've been around for quite a while. One's fairly tall, one's short, one talks, one doesn't. They have a show in Vegas. They are very well-known magicians. And Penn Jillette of that duo claims to be a very devout atheist. And he says that he knows that there is no God. And I have a feeling that if he and I were to hang out, we probably wouldn't agree on a lot of things. But there's one thing that he has said that I 100% agree with, and I would like to read it to you today. It's just a portion of an interview that he gave. There again, he is an atheist, Penn Jillette, and he says, "I just don't respect people who don't proselytize, who don't witness. Because if you believe that there's a heaven and a hell, and if you believe people could be going to hell or not getting eternal life, and you think, well, it's not really worth telling them because it would be socially awkward," he says, "how much do you have to hate somebody to believe that everlasting life is possible and not tell them?" Here's an atheist saying that if you truly believe that people who reject Christ will be lost for all eternity, then you better have the intellectual integrity and the compassionate love to tell them. I mean, let me put it to you this way. If I were to step out of the sanctuary right now, if I were to excuse myself and say, "I just need to get a drink of water, or I'm going to use the restroom, I'll be right back," and I go out in the foyer and I find that the church is on fire. Not in the good way, right? We're not on fire in the good way. We're on fire in the literal, the church building is on fire. I can either go to my, you know, safety myself, I can just run out the door, get out of here, or I can come back into the sanctuary and tell everyone, "Hey, we need to get out, the building is on fire." Which one of those options do you prefer I use? Of course, I need to alert you to the peril that awaits you. I wouldn't take a chance on that. I'd get you quickly moving in the right direction, because if I don't speak up, you're lost. So how much more important for us to share the message of Christ? We don't want anyone to be lost. Talking about the lost, maybe it seems a little uncomfortable. I've had people tell me, you know, it's like calling people names. It's like pointing fingers at people to say, the lost. But here's a very humbling truth. I was once lost, and now I'm found. How many of you could make that same statement? And if we find ourselves with a condescending spirit, pointing our fingers at those who are lost, pronouncing some type of personal judgment on them, then it's clear we've forgotten where we came from. It's clear that we've forgotten the price that it took to win us back. We have to see it. We have to see that some people are just not aware of Jesus. They're not aware of the gospel. And they're just moving through this life totally unaware of the abundant life and the eternal life that God can offer them. You know, when I was a kid, 4 or 5 years old, my great-grandmother had a cottage up on the canal at Crescent Beach. And my dad and I think my grandpa were helping to put grandma's dock in one late spring. And my great-grandma was in charge of watching me, and I'm not really sure why, but for some reason, we were both mad, and I said, I'm going to run away. And my great-grandma said, don't let the door hit you on the way out. So I left and walked along the shoreline a ways down the shoreline, and if I were to think of it in adult terms, not far. If I were to think of it as a four-year-old, too far. I walked away. And one of my great-grandma's neighbors down the way recognized me and knew where I belonged and came down on his golf cart and said, can I give you a ride back to your grandma's house? And I said, no, because you're a stranger. So he followed me back to my great-grandma's house. And went in the house, and we decided we were friends again. She gave me some bread and butter for a snack, and all was well. I didn't find out till much later that in that time when I had walked away, some talk happened along the neighbors with the canal, and somehow that reached a DNR officer. And that DNR officer then reached my mother at the bait shop my parents owned and came in and said, have they found your daughter yet? And my mom said, why? Well, she's lost. And she called my great-grandma's house, and my great-grandma said, no, she's right here. Didn't tell her I had been gone, just said, nope, it's all fine. When my dad and I got home, my mom was a wreck. And I remember at that moment, having thought I just went on an adventure during the day, right? At that moment, I felt scared. Because I didn't realize I had been lost until I was found. You know, there are dozens of people that you rub shoulders with day in and day out who are in a very shaky spiritual condition. They have absolutely no idea that they are lost. They have no idea that they're headed to a Christless eternity. And that's where you come in. To think that you can introduce them to Christ, to think that you can help them be found. Don't you love to see a new Christian and just see that newfound faith? They have so much gratefulness and enthusiasm, and they have this unbridled drive for what we call evangelism. They were lost, they've been found, they want to tell everyone, they want to find everyone, they're so excited. I think it's because they're all too well aware of what it means to have been lost and what it means to be found. And it sets them on a mission. I'm worried, though, that over time, friends, if we're not careful, even if you've experienced that feeling, if you know what it's like, that excitement can fade. Enthusiasm erodes a bit, our boldness is tempered, and our passion kind of drifts. As Christians, we get comfortable being found, and we forget that devastation that we were headed toward. Sometimes it causes us to lose a little bit of our urgency, because the longer we're found, the more we forget what it was like to be lost. And our attitudes start to become a bit like some of the religious people who Jesus didn't have a whole lot of patience for. I want to take you back today to a time around 2,000 years ago, on a day when Jesus is teaching, and while he's teaching, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law are kind of whispering amongst themselves over the fact that there were so many tax collectors and sinners who are gathered around Jesus, listening to him and wanting to hear him teach. And it didn't make much sense to the religious leaders, because they felt that the truly spiritual people were set apart by how they dressed and what they gave and how they prayed, and they were set apart by the people with whom they did not associate. But Jesus is going to adjust their attitude a bit. He's going to drive home the message that lost people matter to him. In fact, he wants to make it so certain that the message comes very clear to them, that he's going to tell three parables in rapid-fire succession. So I want you to take your Bible out, or open your Bible app if that's how you prefer to follow along. I want you to turn to the book of Luke, chapter 15. It's in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, in the back, chapter 15. And I just want you to hold on to that, whether you're looking at it in your Bible or on your phone. Just keep your eyes on that, because we're going to cover the entire 15th chapter of Luke. Some of you actually raised your head when I said that, so take it easy. I have places to be too, it's okay. But we're going to cover all of Luke chapter 15. So if you could just kind of keep looking back and forth, make sure what I'm saying is accurate. Jesus begins and he tells story number one of three. And he tells the story about a man who has 100 sheep. How many of you in your translation say it was Trevin? No? Just making sure my husband is listening. Okay. But he talks about a man who has 100 sheep. And one day he's counting them out in the field, and he realizes that there are only 99 that are there. So what does he do? Jesus says that he leaves the 99 in the open country and he goes in search of the one. And when he finds it, he brings it back on his shoulders. And when he brings it back, he tells his friends and he tells his neighbors and he tells everyone, and they have a celebration because the sheep that was lost has been found. Now, I get to say this because we have sheep. Sheep are not smart. They are not smart animals. They need a shepherd to care for them, to lead them to food, to keep watch over them. And you're going to say, well, there's grass everywhere. How hard is that? They need a shepherd to take them to the grass. They have no defense. They are very defenseless animals. They have to stay in a flock. They have that safety in numbers. If a wild animal were to attack and there is one by itself, that there's no hope, okay? And the reality is, if they're in the fold, if they're with the entire flock and the shepherd is watching over them, that's the only way they maintain safety. And Jesus is telling this story to what I would call an agricultural culture. Many of them have sheep or know what it is to tend sheep, so they're all kind of standing there nodding, and they understand what this is like. And they also understand you leave to go get that lost sheep. Because they all know that if a sheep is lost, it's as good as dead. Because no shepherd ever says, I'll just wait a couple days and it'll come back. They don't come back. Lassie comes home, right? Sheep do not. So then story number two. Jesus says there's a woman in her home and she has 10 silver coins. It's probably her life savings. That's probably everything she has. And in her home, sometimes she counts those 10 silver coins, just makes certain that they're there. And one day she counts them and there are only 9 silver coins. And Jesus says, what will that woman do? She'll sweep that house until she finds the one lost coin. And when she finds it, do you know what she's going to do? Jesus says she's going to tell all of her neighbors, she's going to tell all her friends, and they're going to have a big celebration because what was lost has been found. Story number three. It's of a lost son, probably a parable that you are familiar with, one of the more well-known stories of Jesus. But before we get into it, I want to make sure that you catch this. The impact and the value increases with each story. I'm not saying a silver coin is worth more than a sheep, but what I am saying is the first thing that Jesus was concerned about finding was 1 out of 100. The next thing is 1 out of 10. And the next in this story is 1 out of 2. And he hits straight to the heart because he's talking about a family member. And so Jesus says, a certain father had 2 sons. And this father had his younger son come to him and say, Dad, you know, I want my share of the inheritance now. Just give me what's mine and I'm going to go live my life. And so the father gives him his share of the inheritance and that boy goes off and he squanders his father's wealth in a faraway country with what has been phrased as wild and riotous living. And he comes up with no money and no friends because the friends were gone with the money. And a famine strikes the land and now he's got no food. And Jesus says, so he gets a job, the only place that he can. He starts feeding slop to pigs. That's his job. And he's stinky, smelly, dirty, barefoot. The Bible tells us he's so hungry, but he doesn't have anything to eat. Nobody's giving him anything to eat. And he's so hungry that it says he longed to fill his stomach with the pods that he was giving to the pigs. And in Luke 15, 17 through 19, if you'll look at your Bibles, it says, when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And I love that phrase. It says, when he came to his senses. And I love it because it just shows us it's never sensible to be away from your father. Friends, we don't always change because we see the light. Sometimes we change because we feel the heat. And this guy, he's got nothing. And now he's starving besides. And he's separated from his family. And he's ashamed and he's embarrassed. He was lost. And he knows it. Maybe some of you know that feeling. It's not very fun. But the Bible says he didn't just keep thinking about his situation of being hungry and dying and lost. Instead, he did something about it. Verse 20 says, so he got up and went to his father. And you know, a lot of people think about repenting. A lot of people wonder about repenting, but they don't take action. They don't do anything. But this young man does. And as the younger son returns home in desperation, he's got no idea how he will be received or if he will be received at all. And the father's response, who knows what he's thinking at that point, right? He could be thinking, you know, well, "Son, you've tarnished our family name. Your frivolous ways, your immorality has made us a laughingstock." Or maybe his dad's going to say, you know, he'll be sitting on the porch and he'll say, "Yeah, did you run out of money? I knew you'd come back when you ran out of money." Maybe his response would be more gracious and he'd say, "Okay, you can live with the servants. You're not going to live in the house, but you can stay here." All of these things had to have been swimming through this young man's mind, and he's still practicing that speech over and over again. "Father, I'm not worthy to be called your son. Make me one of your servants." He has no idea what to expect. But we've got to understand that the father's thoughts are just the opposite of everything this young man is thinking, because in this parable, the father represents God the Father. So envision it this way. The father, who represents God, sitting on the porch in a rocking chair, and he's just scanning the horizon like he does every night. Every day he's been diligently praying for his son's return, and one day he sees this silhouette off in the distance, and he thinks, "Maybe that's my son." But he's like, "Well, that can't be him, because when my son left, he was standing so tall and his shoulders were back, and he was really kind of strutting his stuff. He was almost cocky, my son. And this guy off in the distance, his head is downcast. His shoulders are slumped. That can't be my boy." But as that silhouette moves closer and closer, that father begins to realize, that's my son. It's my child. And all the while, that son just continues to practice the speech in his head, what he's going to say when he gets there. "Father, I've sinned against heaven. I've sinned against you. I'm not worthy. Make me one of your servants." But when dad realizes that that's his son, you know what he does? Do you know this story? He starts running toward his son. Running toward him. Do you know why that's significant? It's the only place in the Bible we see God in a hurry. He is relentlessly pursuing the lost. He wants to be in a right relationship. He wants for the two of them to have a right relationship, so he takes off running toward him. And sometimes when I read that, I don't know about you, but I'm thinking, boy, if I were the prodigal, if I've spent my dad's inheritance and I've gotten in all kinds of trouble and riotous living, and I walk up the lane and my dad starts running toward me, I might take off the other way. But this son stays the course. He doesn't retreat. He keeps moving forward. He's come to repent. And when his father gets close to him, he immediately and humbly begins to spout off his speech. "Father, I've sinned against heaven. I've sinned against you. I'm not worthy to be called your son. Make me one of your servants." And I can't help but wonder if the father hears any of that. I'm not sure he hears a word of that speech, because I think he's too busy embracing his son and pulling him close, holding on to him, so happy to have him back and not wanting to let him go. And he looks at his son, and he looks over to his servants, and he says, "Go kill the fatted calf. We're going to have a party to end all parties. Bring out a robe, bring out a ring for him, bring out some sandals, get the Lysol, whatever we need to do." He says, "For this son of mine was dead and is now alive. He was lost and is found." And everyone who hears these three stories from Jesus hears him put the bow on the end of that story, and they go, "Wow, praise the Lord, that's a great story." But it's not the end. I want you to remember why Jesus told the three stories. He had a purpose behind it. He told them because of all this grumbling going on with the religious leaders who were there. It couldn't understand why Jesus, if he was such a good and holy man, why he was spending time with these wicked and vile people, tax collectors, prostitutes. So Jesus continues the story so that he can wisely teach and lovingly rebuke that superior attitude of those religious leaders. Let me paraphrase for you what happens next. The party begins, and the older son comes back in from the fields from working. And he runs into a servant, and he says, "Hey, what's going on? What's with the music up at the house, and what is happening around here?" And the servant says, "Haven't you heard? Your little bro came home. Your dad is so pumped up, he killed the fatted calf, and we're all having steak tonight. Your dad's got a karaoke machine. It is on." And the older brother is furious. It's not fair. He's mad. So let's stop right there for a minute and understand what Jesus is saying, what he's trying to get across to these religious leaders and to us. If you can't get excited when someone changes the direction of their life for the better, then you have some issues to deal with. If that's our attitude, then we've forgotten what it means to be found. When we realize that God has saved us, when we realize what God has saved us from, that should propel us on a mission to reach those who are lost and point them to a Savior. Jesus did not come to this earth to perform miracles. Jesus did not come to this earth to serve the poor. Jesus did not come to this earth to preach good sermons. He did all of those things. But Scripture tells us that Jesus came to this earth to seek and to save that which is lost. And when someone who was lost is found, we better have a celebration. Bottom line, the whole world is full of only two groups of people. You're either saved by the blood of the Lamb, or you are lost. Believing that everybody is in one of those two groups, that means that every man, every woman, every child that you come in contact with is either a member of the body of Christ and should be encouraged by you, or they are lost and they deserve and need to hear about the love of God from you. John 3:16 very simply says, "For God, Almighty God, the creator of all of heaven, all of earth, so loved the world," that's us, "that he gave his only begotten Son," that's Jesus, "that whosoever would believe in him would not perish but would have everlasting life." We have an obligation to share the good news of Jesus with every single person we come in contact with. And I would pray that we may do just that through our lives and through our words. Amen. Friends, if you need a little practice in what to say to some of those folks, would you open your hymnals? Let's stand and sing together, "Jesus Saves." It's number 438 in your hymnal.
Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Please be seated. As we come to a time of prayers of the people, as I do every week, I'll direct you to that bulletin. Any special prayer requests that we might have will be printed there, as well as those suggestions for you in praying for our church family. Again, those in that second paragraph there where it says, who or what else can I pray for this week? Those are your church brothers and sisters and friends, and nothing specifically has happened that they have asked to have their name there. That's just how we're going to keep one another in prayer. Also, if we have community events or things that you might suggest to be listed there, let us know in the office and we'll be happy to acknowledge those as well. Any joys or concerns this morning? Again, Rod has a microphone in the back and is happy to travel to you. So, clear up front.
I see it on Tuesday. Those with ongoing medical treatments.
Yes.
And it just happens that on Tuesday I have a stress test, and I'm kind of worried about it.
I don't think it's going to help your stress test if you're worried about the stress test. The power of prayer can be a great thing, so we will be thinking of you, Joanne. Also, we've got, there again, just those in our church family and friends and in our community that continue to have those medical treatments, those tests or those diagnoses that they are working with, keep those people in your prayers. Even if we throw that big blanket out and pray for everyone who might be in that circumstance, I think that's a fair and appropriate prayer at any time. So, any others?
I wanted to thank everyone for praying for my mom last week. She had COVID and she's doing much better. So thank you so much.
Others, joys, concerns? I know I've mentioned before, but you know, Mr. Lockie was my PE teacher in school, so I enjoy very much telling him to run around in here. So I think it'd be only appropriate. A prayer concern up front, one in the back up front, one in, no, okay. Pick up the little eraser and take it down and set it down, no, okay. I don't still think you're mean, Rod. Hearing no others, let's go to our Lord in prayer. Gracious and loving God, search us, know us, hear our prayers. We're reminded to come to you always first and foremost with humble hearts full of gratitude. How might we express our thankfulness, Lord, for all that you are, all that you do? We're just so thankful that you are God. And what a joy it is to be in relationship with you, to be found. For those times of happiness, celebration, whether that's new babies or new jobs or a sense of renewal, whatever those circumstances are that bring those smiles to our faces, Lord, we're so thankful for the blessings that you've bestowed upon us in so many different ways, and we acknowledge that all good things come from you, Lord. And for those other times, those other moments, where we understand the biblical meaning of joy, Lord, but we don't always feel it. We don't understand how sometimes things can go wrong, how we can have those moments of perhaps fear or unhappiness or that feeling of being lost. That's when we're asking you, Lord, to step in to offer that healing, to offer that mending of fences, to bridge those gaps for us so that we can have your peace and your security. And again, we acknowledge What a beautiful privilege and opportunity, whatever our burdens are, Lord, that we can bring them to you, that we can leave them with you and trust you to show us how to work through it. You walk alongside of us, and we are so thankful. Again, for those who need that special type of attention, that healing, we lift them up to you today, Lord. I ask that you would continue to guide us on the path that you have chosen for us, that we might indeed be gathering those who are lost and help them to be found. We pray that, Lord, you will equip us and empower us to do our part, and we trust you to do your part, and we're so thankful to be in relationship with you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I did want to take briefly a moment as we prepare to dismiss this morning to acknowledge tomorrow is our nation's Independence Day. It's a great time to pray with a thankful heart, to give thanks that we have the freedoms we are afforded in this country. And also, friends, it's a good time to pray for those who don't have those same freedoms, who might know some oppression or that lack of privilege or opportunity that we so blessedly enjoy here. And we give thanks for the men and women who gained that independence for us. As you leave this place today, may our Lord bless you and keep you always. Amen. Let's stand and sing together our closing hymn today, again in recognition of our country's independence, America the Beautiful, number 799 in your hymnal.